Hello, morning. Today we come to the end of our prayer journey through the four Sundays of Advent. On the first Sunday, we were reminded that we are God's people. On the second Sunday, we gave thanks for the Old Testament prophets. And last week we remembered and gave thanks for John the Baptist, the forerunner of Christ. Today on this fourth Sunday in Advent, traditionally the focus for our prayer is Jesus' mother, Mary, for her willingness and her obedience to God's will. The Gospel writers, Matthew and Luke, introduce us to Mary, an unassuming young girl, maybe still in her teens, who's looking forward to her impending wedding to the village carpenter. The angel Gabriel visited Mary and told her that God had chosen her to give birth to a son, and he was to be given the name Jesus. In obedience to God's will, Mary responded with the words, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." So scripture to lead us into our prayer this morning from Luke's Gospel, the words, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." So let us pray. King of kings, yet born of Mary, you come to dwell among us in great humility. Thank you that you reveal the great love of God towards us and that we are called to be his own people. Come now among us and give us your peace, that we may live to your praise and glory through Christ our Saviour, who is alive and lives and reigns with the Father and the Spirit for ever and ever. Amen. In the church that looks for you, among the people who proclaim you, with all who seek to serve you, with all who dedicate their lives to you, with all who proclaim that they love you, now with us here in church or at home online, we worship you. We worship you with your church in Stechford, with your church in England, and with your church throughout the world. Emmanuel, God, you are with us. With the nations striving towards the light, with the seekers for freedom and justice, with those who enrich and extend our lives, with all who bring peace on earth, with the peoples lost in darkness, and with the nations caught up in war. Emmanuel, God, you are with us. In our homes as we prepare for your coming, in our relationships and in our loving, in our sharing and in our caring, in our actions and our interactions within our community. Emmanuel, God, you are with us. With the outcasts and the poor, with the unemployed and the homeless, with the scorned and rejected, with the refugees and the stateless, with the persecuted and those who suffer injustice. Emmanuel, God, you are with us. With all who are in pain or sorrow, with all who are sick, with all who are anxious, with all who fear the future, and with those whose lives on earth is coming to an end. Emmanuel, God, you are with us. With our friends who are ill, and with those who we know in need of our prayer, with Eunice, with Pastor George, with Valerie, with Harold, with Sergio, with David, with Elisa, with Nina, with Carol Ann's partner Chris, with Marlene, with Bernadette and Colin. Emmanuel, God, you are with us. With those who may have joined us for this first time, I invite you to join with us to pray for yourself or name anyone or anything that you would like us to include in our prayers. In a short time of shared silence, let us bring to God in prayer people in need known only to ourselves. And a reminder of the words from Luke's Gospel, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Please join with me with words spoken or unspoken in saying the Lord's Prayer, using your preferred language or translation. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And our final prayers. For our final prayer today, we'll have Mary's song of praise found in the first chapter of the Gospel of Luke. Mary's song of praise, also known as Magnificat. Magnificat is said daily by many churches throughout the world. My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Saviour, for he has looked with favour on the lowliness of his servant. Surely, from now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham, and to his descendants forever. And our blessing. God is with you, a light to your path, a companion on the road, a friend for your journey, a sure support and presence at all times. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you now and always. Amen. If you'd like us to pray for you or for a loved one, or if you'd like to talk with one of us about our faith, the scriptures, or our church, then please do contact us at Stechford Baptist Church. And the online address is stechfordbaptist.org.uk, and we'll be in touch. So thank you.
Oh, holy night, the stars are brightly shining, it is the night dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till he appears and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope, the weary world rejoices, for yonder brings a new and glorious morn. Fall on your knees, oh, hear the angels' voices, oh, my divine. Thank you.
Welcome to Advent 2020 and our sermon series on the four traditional themes during Advent of hope, peace, joy, and love. Today we come to the fourth and final Sunday in Advent, in which we talk about love. Why love? I hate to say it, but some men have a difficult time going to that subject at all, about love. And for some reason, I think a lot of men think that it is unmanly to speak about love. And I suppose that probably in some ways, I feel like I was raised in an environment where where love was just not something that was talked about. Love is a subject that makes a lot of men uncomfortable. We'd much rather talk about things that are much more active or apparently manly. And the surprising thing that I want all you men to understand is that the same Old Testament that is quite a manly narrative that goes on, you know, there's lots of war, there's lots of fighting, there's lots of action, there's lots of, you know, swords being flung around and blood being shed. But at the same time that all that is going on, there is an amazing amount of love that is talked about. And, you know, for me to come to understand that in really more recent times, it's a bit of a challenge to me, my preconceptions about men and love. Now, the word love in our English New International Version of the Bible occurs 733 times in the whole Bible. More than half of those are in the Old Testament. 423 occurrences of the word love in the English Bible are found in the Old Testament, the place where all the warfare and the blood and everything goes on. And then I really started to discover this recently going through the book of Psalms. We only got as far as chapter 18 in our study thus far in the book of Psalms. And in the book of Psalms, one thing that's become very clear is that even though there is a lot of talk about enemies and hostility and fighting and people trying to kill one another, David talks an awful lot about God's love for him and his love for God. So it's okay for men to talk about love. It's okay for men to think about the love. And in fact, it's not just okay, it's essential that we talk about these things. Today, I would like to look at the subject of love from four different angles. First, we will look at God's love for us. Second, we will look separately at Christ's love for us, as separate from God's love for us. Third, let's look at our love for God. And finally, fourth, and it's almost by way of application, but it's also it's a response out of those earlier points, our love for one another. John 3:16 is perhaps the most famous, most often quoted verse of the Bible, the most memorized, the most recognized verse out of the Bible. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. When we come to the season of Advent, what is actually happening is the acting out of this very verse of Scripture, John 3:16. It's the expression of God's love by giving his Son. And God gave his Son on Christmas Day as his Christmas gift to all mankind. Sometimes we talk about the wise men, the Magi from the East, as kind of the example given for gift giving and the impetus for it in the first place as they brought gifts to the baby Jesus. But in fact, the real giving of Christmas predates that. It's God's gift to us. God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. That is a verse that is so full of meaning. I mean, it speaks about the object of God's love, which is the world by which we mean people, all people in the world, all people everywhere, everyone. So God loves everyone. He loves them so much that he gave his one and only son. And this shows the extent of God's love. That God loves the world so much. How does he show it? He loves it so much that he gave the thing that he loved more than anything else, and that's his own son. So God loves us that much that he gives the thing that is most precious to him, his beloved son. We can understand that more clearly when we look at the life of Abraham. Now, in the Old Testament, the word that is most commonly translated love is the Hebrew word ahab. And this word ahab is first found in Genesis chapter 22, verse 2. It says, "Then God said, 'Take your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains I will tell you about.'" This is the first use of ahab. This word ahab is the word behind that phrase where it says, "Isaac, whom you love." Abraham, we know that Abraham, if you know the story of Abraham, how much Abraham loved Isaac. He'd been waiting his whole life to have a son. And Isaac is precious to him more than anything else in the world. And Abraham was challenged to give up his son out of his devotion for God, to look at a bigger picture, to love God so much that he would be willing to give the thing that is most precious to him. And this first use of the word love, ahab, in the Old Testament, shows us what it must have been like for God the Father to give his son, his precious son. It wasn't an easy thing for God to love the world of people, you and me, so much that he would give his only son as a sacrifice. The Apostle John wrote more about God's love and tried to explain it for us by saying this. "This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only son into the world that we might live through him." This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. God loved us, and that's what Advent love should make us think of. Not our love for God, not our love for one another, primarily. We have to begin with God's love for us. And in verse 10, where it says that this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us, this identifies the common error of human religion. And the error of human religion, where all of the faiths of the world, including false versions of Christian faith, is that it's rooted in trying to demonstrate your love for God by your good works and your devotion to God. But that is not what it's about. Wherever you go around the world, people worship, and they feel that there is importance in loving the Creator and showing that love for the Creator by doing good and by sincere devotion in worship. The error that we can fall into is in thinking that that is what it's all about, that that is the main thing. But in fact, what the Bible teaches us, that as important as that is, after all, the greatest commandment is to love the Lord your God. As important as that is, there is something greater than that. And that is, it's not that we love God, but that He loves us. It's God's love. That's the greatest thing. That's the most important thing for us to understand. We have to start there, and then we're in a better position to think about how we would go about loving God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. So this is the error that's identified. It is not that we loved God. In fact, the Bible's teaching is that, in fact, we do not by nature love God. And even sometimes when we attempt to love God, it can become a counterfeit, a fake love for God. We can even be deceived ourselves. There was a time in the life of the nation of Israel when they stood in a place to renew the covenant that they had made as a people with the Lord God. And Joshua is the one who leads them in this. And he challenges them with the demands of what it means to be in relationship to God. He says in chapter 24, verse 14, "Now fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. Throw away the gods your forefathers worshiped beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord." And so, yeah, he spoke to them more and showed them that he and his own family were going to endeavor to faithfully follow the Lord. And you know what? The people answered, "Far be it from us to forsake the Lord to serve other gods. It was the Lord our God himself who brought us and our fathers up out of Egypt from that land of slavery and performed those great signs before our eyes. He protected us on our entire journey and among all the nations through which we traveled. And the Lord drove out before us all the nations, including the Amorites who lived in the land. And the people say, 'We too will serve the Lord because he is our God.'" Look at now at Joshua's response to this. Joshua doesn't like what they said. And he says, what is perhaps the most shocking thing in the entire Old Testament. He says this: "You are not able to serve the Lord. He is a holy God. He is a jealous God. He will not forgive your rebellion and your sins." Point blank, Joshua says that they cannot serve God, they cannot worship him, they cannot love God in the way that the law requires, because God is holy and God is jealous, and they must be 100% faithful to him, if they're going to be in covenant with him. So he points to the basic inability of the people to actually follow through on what all the religions of the world would promote, and that is faithful devotion and worship to God, faithfulness to him, and really loving him properly with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. So as verse 10 says, this is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. The very fact that the law demanded such a 100% kind of love, pointing out our inability to actually fulfill it, and therefore God sent his Son as a sacrifice for our sins, our failure to love. See, it shows that the error of man-made religion in trying to love God without God's help, but it also shows the solution. God loved us That's the solution. That's why it's the greatest thing, even greater than that great, greatest commandment. God's love motivated him to send his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins so that we could be saved, so that we could truly worship and love God. So true Christianity is in verse 10 in the latter part. It's all about God loving us and sending Jesus to die for our sins. And that has a life-transforming effect on us. We've looked at God's love for us as the most important thing. I want to also talk about Christ's love for us as a slightly a separate issue. Because God demonstrates his love for us by sending his son. He gives his son. But what about how does Christ show his love for us? He doesn't send his son. No, it's found in the other John 3:16. 1 John 3:16 or 1 John 3:16 says, "This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers." So what is love, according to this verse? We know what love is by looking at Jesus, laying down his life for us. So the Father showed his love for us by sending his Son. The Son showed his love by giving his own life and laying it down. And then the examples set there for us to lay our lives down for our brothers, just as Jesus laid his life down for us as an application. So Christ's love means that he gave his own life, and we should respond to that kind of love by emulating it, loving one another. This is a point that is emphasized again and again in the New Testament. The Apostle Paul also speaks of this in talking about the marriage relationship. And so I'm speaking to you men in relationship to Christ's love for his people. When he says, "Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless." Now there is a tall order for Jesus to bring about in relationship to the church, and that is to prepare her for her wedding day, make her holy and cleanse her, make her radiant without stain or blemish or any wrinkle, but absolutely without anything that could be a blame. How is Jesus going to purify his church to that degree that there's not a defect is seen? By giving his life. That's how. And this is set forth before husbands as the measure of the love that they should have for their wives. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church. Now, Jesus loved the church and gave himself up for her. So he loved it enough to die for it. He loved it enough to live for it. And, you know, for us men, think that in many cases with men who love their wives, when put to the test, they probably would lay down their lives for their wives, would be willing to risk their own lives to protect their wives. The really difficult thing, I think in a lot of cases, is living for your wife, because that is a lifelong thing and it's day in and day out. And really living for your wife, laying your life down for your wife as a husband. That is where we can get off the track. That's where we can forget to have, you know, to each day we have to commit ourselves to love our wives in word, in action, in how we live our lives, and what we do for them. So, you know, and it's up to you as a husband to understand what you need to do to show love for your wife in a way that she will understand. Let me take this opportunity to recommend a website, 5lovelanguages.com. You can go to that website, and if you're not sure really what in which way someone needs to show love to you, what would really strike home to your heart, you can take a self-test by answering questions there. It's completely anonymous. You don't have to do anything other than just complete it. And you go through a series of questions, and you'll find out what is your love language. What is it that speaks to you? And there's also quizzes there for couples, for teenagers, for singles, for children. So we can learn about what is it that really says to an individual, I love you. So husbands, it would really be good for you to identify your love language and give the results to your wife, and vice versa, for you to find out what your wife's love language is, and then begin to practice love according to what is going to actually be heard by the one you're trying to show love to. It makes it much easier to accept that love. Let's learn how to love one another. You have to get to know what it is that really says to your wife, this shows that you love me. And then you have to do that. And that can be sacrificial. It can be very difficult. But that is what we are called to do as men. The Bible never calls upon wives to love their husbands. And I think that's because wives are pretty good at doing that, loving their husbands. But it's a more difficult thing for men to love their wives. But it's oh so necessary, because you, as a Christian man, you show the world what the love of Christ is really like by the way you treat your wife. So this Advent, and we come into this Christmas season, we should think seriously about what the demonstration of love is going to look like for me as a Christian man and husband. Our love for God, thirdly. This is more familiar territory for us. This is what I was referring to earlier when I talked about really many of the religions, if not most of the religions of the world, would have something similar to the idea of the fact that we must devote ourselves to God. We must do things for God, show our devotion to Him, our love for Him. As Deuteronomy chapter 6 calls upon the nation of Israel, Moses says to the people, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up." Love for God constitutes the greatest commandment. And when you think about the law of Moses and the Ten Commandments particularly, the basic demand of the law, the real meaning underneath every commandment that you can think about, whether it's the command to not murder, the command to not steal, or to not bear false witness, whatever other command there might be, the basic demand of those commands is to love God. This is how you demonstrate your love for God. And Jesus agrees with that when he says, when he's asked about this very thing, what's the greatest commandment? And he says, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, says Jesus. And then the second is like it. He says, love your neighbor as yourself. And then he makes an amazing statement. All of the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. So this is what that body of laws and regulations is all about. It's about loving God and loving your neighbor. Future rewards are promised for those who love God and for those who wait for him. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9 speaks of this, where it says, however, as it is written, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love him. The implication here is that this is what's necessary if you want to be rewarded by God in the future. You want to go to heaven, then you have to be counted among those people of whom it is said that they love God. See, God prepares these things for those who love him. James agrees in what he says in chapter 2, verse 5. He says, listen, my dear brothers, has not God chosen those who are poor in the eyes of the Lord to be rich in faith and to inherit the kingdom he promised to those who love him? There it is again. Those who love God are promised an eternal kingdom. And then looking ahead to the return of the Lord Jesus, the day of his second coming, the Apostle Paul says in 2 Timothy 4, verse 8, there is in store for me the crown of righteousness which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award me on that day, not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. Now, the word longed there in the NIV version of the Bible is actually, in the Greek, it is that word, Greek word for love, agapao. And that's why other more literal translations, such as the English Standard Version, would say that very thing. Henceforth, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have loved his appearing. Love. Love for God and love for the return of our God and Lord Jesus into this world. Finally, let's look at our love for one another. This was something that Jesus really tried to impress upon his disciples as a number one command for his disciples to follow. In John 13, 34, 35, he says, a new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. And again, John was so impressed upon that, he spoke about it quite a bit in his first letter. In chapter 4, verse 7 and 8, he says, dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God, and whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. So love comes from God, and that's what we've been saying all along. That's why we started with the love that God has for mankind. God, it's not that we loved God, but that God loved us. He is the initiator of love. And love is a relationship. Without two parties, there is really no love. Love has to not only be given, but it has to be accepted as well. and we must accept God's love. That's what John 3:16 has to say, actually. It says that for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him, see, that's the accepting part, the accepting of God's love. Whoever believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. So the promise of a future with God that is promised to those who love him can be yours when you accept God's love for you. If you believe in him, then you're in a position then to love God, because one of the things that God does in sending Jesus into the world to die for us, when we respond to God's love, God sends his Holy Spirit into our lives and he gives us new birth, that Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit begins to bear fruit in our lives. The very first fruit, and therefore the primary fruit, the most important fruit, is what? Love, the first named fruit. The fruit of the Spirit is love. It's not without reason that love is number one, because love is the most important thing. All of the songwriters understand that. John Lennon understood it when he said, "All you need is love." And the songwriter who wrote "What the World Needs Now Is Love, Sweet Love," is that Burt Bacharach? I don't know. That is absolutely true. God knows that. That's why God loves us and sent his Son into the world for us. And that's why the Apostle John then can say that everyone who loves, in the way we're talking about now, everyone who loves, responds to God's love and believes in God, and the fruit of the Spirit of love is born in your life. You begin to love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. You begin to love your neighbor. Well, everyone who loves has been born of God. It's not those who love their own family. Every human being loves something. Some people love themselves. Some people love their toys and their things, their money, their wealth. Some people love their family, and that's a great thing, their loved ones. But the love that God showed us is a love that's demonstrated to rebels, people who hate him in many cases, people who don't want anything to do with God, who wish he would just not exist. And so that in wishful thinking, they convince themselves that there is no God. God loves those kinds of people. And God loves those kinds of people so much that he sent his Son, so that whoever accepts his love and believes in his Son will not perish but have eternal life. So everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God, but whoever does not love like this does not know God, because God is love. To John, that is the second letter written by John, verse 6 says, "And this is love, that we walk in obedience to his commands. As you have heard from the beginning, his command is what? Is that you walk in love." You know, fulfilling God's legal requirements by loving God and loving your neighbor. Walk in love. Isn't that great? And then going back to his first letter, John's first letter, in chapter 4, verse 11 and 12. "Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. May God bless you this fourth Sunday in Advent as we look forward to Christmas Day. Realize that Christmas, the coming of Jesus into this world, is all about God's love for us and our love for him and for one another.
Oh,